V2PTE Academic. We are providing online PTE coaching and monthly practice test. You can also stay connected with us. Facebook, Instagram and Telegram. For more information visit our WhatsApp on given number. Subscribe our YouTube channel and press the bell icon for more updates.
This is Scientific Americans, 60 Second Science. I'm Steve Mursky. Got a minute? Why do bumblebees pick some flowers over others? Researchers have known for a while that a flower's color can be a signal. Color is shorthand that says to a bee, hey, I got some good quality nectar here. Why don't you stop by for a visit? But new findings show that bees also use color to get clues about a flower's temperature. And according to a study from a British research team published in the journal Nature, some like it hot. Bees use up a lot of energy just staying warm on some days. In fact, they can't even fly if they're too cold. So if one flower is warmer than another, a bee can save some of its fuel by basking on that flower while it's doing its pollinating business. And it turns out that bumblebees consistently do choose warmer flowers over cooler ones, even when the two flowers offered up the same quantity and quality of nectar. Some plants seem to be evolutionarily adapted to be slightly warmer because the warmer ones get visited more by the chilly bees. When it comes to getting pollinated, apparently the heat is on, and that's the buzz.
The history of software is, of course, very, very new. The whole IT industry is really only 67 years old, which is extraordinary. And to be so close to the birth of a major new technology, a major new discipline, is quite remarkable given where we've got to in those 67 years. And the progression has been not so much a progression as a stampede, because Moore's law, the rapid expansion in the power of computing and the rapid fall of the cost of computing and storage and communications, has made it feasible for information technology to move into all sorts of areas of life that were never originally envisaged. What has happened is that there has been, as I said, a stampede for people to pick the low-hanging fruit. And that is what's guided the development of software and information technology over the past decades and continues to do so, with a number of consequences that we will explore.
To be a successful entrepreneur, you should have a good idea, but the definition of a good idea varies depending on whom you ask. A great idea should have several features. Firstly, the great idea should be various and novel. Secondly, the great idea should be unique, which means no one has thought about it. Thirdly, it is essential for great ideas to be transformative and productive. All ideas essentially are a combination of other smaller ideas, but this doesn't mean they can't be unique. Merely copying doesn't make anything idiosyncratic. It's the individuality that one puts in which they make a concept stand out. Constant innovation leaves no room for stagnation, and thus adds on the basic idea, effectively making it unique. Unique ideas are inspired by basic things. They are simply extensions of pre-existing notions. And an idea or a concept is unique only when it transcends its predecessor and it serves its purpose in a better and more precise way.
He said, innovation equals invention and let me just stop here innovation equals invention. Often people mistake these two things for the same thing. Innovation equals invention. They are not. Innovation is something that generates value for the world. It makes something faster, better, cheaper. It gives someone some great satisfaction. An invention is an idea, a technology, a patent. In and of itself, it does not generate value. So these two are not the same thing. And sometimes you see them interchange, and that's not correct. So innovation equals invention times commercialization. So, and when we look at this equation of innovation, something of value, it requires a new idea, and then it requires someone or some organization that is going to commercialize that idea.
The shuttle was designed to be a space truck. It's a multi-purpose vehicle. We've done a tremendous number of different things with it. It's the most versatile space vehicle that has ever been built. We've used it to launch satellites. We've used it to repair satellites in orbit and put them back into orbit. We've used it to capture satellites and bring them back to Earth for repair. We've outfitted it with the space lab built by our European partners and used it before the era of the space station to do scientific research. We used it as part of our partnership with the Russians, which is still continuing, first as part of the Mir space station, where we actually prolonged the useful life of Mir by several years through logistical supply visits with the shuttle. And now, of course, we're using it to build the new International Space Station.